Hi again, this is Russ Bleemer, the editor of Alternatives for the CPR Institute. And I'm with Phil Loree from New York and Richard Faulkner from Dallas. We're talking on Monday, June 1st, in the wake of the GE Energy versus Outokumpu case that came down from the U.S. Supreme Court today. Gentlemen, we talked a little before we got going. This seems like an unsurprising opinion. At first, when it went to the court, it was straightforward. If the party hasn't signed the arbitration agreement, the party doesn't have to arbitrate under the 1958 New York Convention. But as it turned out, Justice Thomas cleared that up right away in the case. He said that addresses the recognition of the arbitration agreement, not enforcement. And with that, it goes back. Equitable estoppel can be applied by the lower court. The opinion ringingly endorses equitable estoppel and state law doctrines to be applied to international convention-worthy arbitration agreements. So it seems straightforward than that. What are the practice implications of it? And what do you guys think is really going on here? Richard, you want to start?
I think what's going on is the Supreme Court has recognized the American basis of the law, but is leaving open the problems with uniformity because European countries and Asian countries are going to look at this and say, okay, great, equitable estoppel under whose law? And that is a huge problem. We are a federal union of 50 states and Puerto Rico, every one of which is different. You've got different standards for equitable estoppel, for unconscionability. Does anyone think the standards in California, Texas, New York, or New Jersey are the same? How does this decision promote international uniformity? And, you know, it makes sense from a standpoint of U.S. domestic law, but it is not necessarily the best thing in the world that could have ever happened to international arbitration. Now, this is the first time, as Lonnie Shuler has noted, that the court has looked at the New York Convention area for about 6 or 7 years. And so this is a unanimous decision. It makes some really good points, and I think we're going to find that it will enhance the lower court's tendencies to send everything to arbitration. Now, interestingly enough, arbitration in this case is going to mean arbitration in Dusseldorf, Germany, under the substantive law of the Federal Republic of Germany. And what they are going to do with all of this when the case ultimately eventually makes its way to Germany is very difficult to predict, because that is a civil law jurisdiction with different doctrines that are advantageous or disadvantageous depending upon which side of the docket you're on.
Phil, did that play into the fight over whether they should go to arbitration or not? What are the practice implications here?
Well, the practice implications in a case like this, coming from the standpoint of the petitioner, who's located in France and has been hailed into an Alabama court to answer for alleged design defect claims or whatnot, yeah, in the production of some sophisticated equipment. I mean, obviously, they're going to want to arbitrate this case, and I think also coming from a civil law jurisdiction, France, they're probably happy to arbitrate it in Germany, and they are, you know, the case still has to go back to the 11th Circuit, and there still has to be a determination as to whether or not equitable estoppel applies at all in this case, or whether perhaps you could find in that there was a, you had to arbitrate under a third party beneficiary theory or something. So, but I do think that the conclusion for that will be, yeah, arbitration. But then, as Rick was saying, they're off to Dusseldorf, Germany. And the concern that I think I have, and I don't know, I think Rick may have it too, is that, well, when you get to Germany, then what happens? You know, that, and obviously GE Power wants to be there, but what if the German courts say, well, you know, you can sign a contract. You know, it's a civil law jurisdiction. They're not necessarily bound by res judicata that you would have from the U.S. court's treatment of all this. So that's a risk for them. But I think that they're probably hoping that's not going to be a huge risk, because they're clearly better off in Dusseldorf. Yes, arbitration is going to be expensive. It'll be before the ICC. But probably from a merit standpoint, they're better off there.
Yeah,
I tend to agree with that on the merits. The expense is going to be astronomical.
Yes.
Unfortunately, ICC arbitrations are always very expensive. It's probably going to run somewhere between $900,000 and $1.15 million just in arbitrator fees and administrative costs. If the parties had non-administered arbitration, they could save about $100,000 right there. But the other issues are going to be related to how the German courts, which will have the first decision on whether or not any ultimate award is enforceable or not, are going to view all of this kerfluffle in Alabama and all the way up to the United States Supreme Court. They may or may not be terribly impressed by that. I'm originally civil law trained.
Do you think it's an overall a bad idea that the court has opened up here and they've done it pretty clearly that state law doctrines are going to apply to convention cases? Is that going to be detrimental when you're in courts in Germany or wherever?
I think it could be. And one of the problems is going to be how many non-American companies understand that the United States is a federal union of 50 sovereign states in the Commonwealth of Puerto Rico, and that the law is different in each one. That does not promote uniformity in any way, shape, or form. And I've had friends of mine who are lawyers in Germany and France and even in England say, well, we just want the law of the United States to apply. Really, which one? And that's going to be problematic because, you know, until you start explaining it, only the Australians and the Canadians really catch on what a federal republic is. So uniformity hasn't exactly been enhanced by this.
Phil, do you have thoughts on how the costs played into this here as well?
Well, do I have thoughts on the costs? I was going to add to what Rick was saying with the, okay, with the lack of uniformity. You can certainly compensate for that with choice of law provisions, which of course are fairly common in these international contracts. I'm not sure if there was one or not in this one. Arbitration's in Dusseldorf, but I'm not sure what law is supposed to apply.
The substantive law is the federal Republic of Germany.
Okay, but here's another, and so that raises a question, and then another question comes up. Well, that may be true for the choice of law clause, but does that the same law that applies to the claim that the subcontractor, is or is not able to benefit from the arbitration clause, which is in the same contract, no doubt, as the choice of law clause. So you have that thorny choice of law clause or choice of law issue as well. In terms of how the costs will play out, I guess, and I'll let Rick elaborate on this because I know he's done all the math and everything on it. Main contractor, the plaintiff in the Alabama court, isn't going to be very happy if it ends up in Dusseldorf, Germany, arbitrating this with all these other things going on. And one important consideration is that you've got arbitration costs, and I understand there are insurers that are subrogees and whatnot. So, you know, it's possible that some assessment of those costs could end up in an early resolution of this case.
The good news is about two-thirds of all of these arbitrations settle. So now that we have, whenever the courts in Alabama get finished with this, now we'll have an opportunity for an intelligent evaluation of potential settlement, because eventually it looks as though this case is going to Dusseldorf to be determined under German law. Phil raised a wonderful point of what happens when the law that the plaintiff in Alabama was asserting is also perhaps the tort law of Alabama. What are the German arbitrators going to do with that? I've talked to quite a few of my German friends in English, thank God, because my German's that bad now after 50 years. But, you know, they are a little bemused by the way we approach case law and the common law of the United States. And unlike Louisiana, where tort law is within the code, in the rest of the United States, it's pretty much made up through the jurisprudence and the common law, which is quite foreign, literally, to what the German arbitrators are apt to expect. One thing I was hoping we can get to, though, is I see a very interesting point by Justice Sotomayor, and that is she gave a clear shot across the bow to anybody thinking about arbitration in the domestic context that consent is key. And that is really going to cause some issues in the future. We have enough problems with what does unconscionability mean across the various U.S. states, but what does consent mean?
You think she was getting it at the unconscionability cases as well here? I mean, this doesn't speak to that, but she said it, you know, she says right here, it's foundational. It's part and parcel of the Federal Arbitration Act. That's an exact quote.
Yeah.
I think that is a perfect lead in to unconscionability analyses and things of that nature. Where did someone truly consent? And if you look at the case law out of, say, New Jersey, where they have some very interesting approaches to, quote, what consent is, I think the case is Adelaide out of the New Jersey Supreme Court, and even sophisticated parties have been found not to consent to arbitration because it was not recited in the arbitration language that it was an alternative to court and that parties were giving up certain substantive rights. Go back to what the original Uniform Arbitration Act says and the ways that the various states have enacted it, and clear indications of a need for clear and unmistakable consent are manifest throughout the Uniform Arbitration Act and the revised Uniform Arbitration Act. So, you know, Bill and I had some interesting conversations about Kaplan. This may be back, you know, right into the clear and unmistakable requirements that Kaplan imposes for arbitrability.
And I'm going to, with that, with that, I'm going to throw in a plug for Mr. Faulkner and Mr. Loree's articles that are in the May and the June issues of Alternatives. You'll find them at altnewsletter.com. The June issue should be posted within the next 48 hours or so. I'll leave Phil with the last word. Do you agree with Richard and I that there is some resonance in this very deliberate concurrence by Justice Sotomayor about this principle and foundation of arbitration consent?
Absolutely. I think, as I said earlier, when I wasn't being recorded, it's a very intelligent dissent, very short and to the point. But what she was getting at, I suspect that she says this coming from the Second Circuit, which has seen so many of these non-signatory cases, and I mean they take up quite a bit of space in the federal reporters, but what she's saying is there are a lot of theories out there, and those theories are often described in a very general sense. You know, it's incorporation by reference. There's assignment through an agent, through equitable estoppel, on and on. But as Rick was pointed out, it's different in every state. And there, apparently in this case, in the case before the Supreme Court, as I said before, there was language in the main contract that really, in my mind, clearly says that, and I think it was in her mind too, because she mentions it in the footnote, that clearly said that the subcontractor was a party. So she didn't even think that we really needed to get into equitable estoppel, but she noted that there were about three different definitions of equitable estoppel that were being bandied about during the case, and then at least one of them was one where there was very little connection, if any, between the person asserting the equitable estoppel and the contract and the contract and the, you know, the party who, you know, to the main party, the contract against, you know, the adversary, the contractor in this case. So, you know, with that in mind, I think you as attorneys, whenever you do look at these cases, non-signatory cases, you got to ask the question that that she's asking, and you have to assume that I think a lot of the lower courts are going to say, well, that is part of the analysis here, based on, you know, because it was really a limited holding that there was no conflict, but certainly the court didn't purport to say, well, you know, to define for every case what non-signatory doctrines were good and
and ultimately, that's it. It was a very limited holding. There is no conflict between the FAA's application of state principles like equitable estoppel directly, but others as well, and the convention, the New York Convention. So it is limited, but as we just left it with Justice Sotomayor, there are certainly a lot of language to look at closely that we'll be dealing with for a while. Thanks for joining us, gentlemen. I appreciate it. We'll put a link to a CPR Speaks blog post up underneath this video so you can see the details on the case, as well as a link to the case itself. Gentlemen, thank you very much.
Great. All
Thanks
so much.
Thanks.
Take care.
Bye. Rick.